Good to have you with us for class this morning. Our numbers are a little slim, but we're glad that you're with us. We'll be in Matthew chapter 24, finishing that Matthew 24, and starting in Matthew 25, verses 1 through 13. Let's bow for a prayer as we begin. Dear Lord, again, we thank you for your word, and we pray you be with us today as we study it. Help us to understand and make application of your word for us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. It starts with this phrase, but immediately after the tribulation. Now, I'm going to talk about that in a few moments, because my suspicion is the tribulation is the material that we got in the first part of chapter 24. You may remember that Jesus is with the disciples, and they're on the Mount of Olives, and they're looking out at the temple, and they talk about how grand the temple is. And he says, not one stone will be left standing on another. And then they ask him sort of three questions. It's really interesting because there's sort of three questions. The first one is, when will these things happen? When is Jerusalem going to be destroyed? And then, when are you coming? And then, when will the end time be? Now, I'm not sure that they understood that his coming and the end time were the same times. But those are the same. So in reality, it's sort of two questions. By the way, if you're from a church that believes in the tribulation, you're going to make those three separate times, because they're going to argue that Jesus is going to come back and take some folks and not be seen by a lot of folks, but take some folks with him and then leave the others behind. We'll see that in our text in a few moments. Immediately after the tribulations, in those of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the sun's stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. After Jesus had predicted the fall of Jerusalem, the disciples asked these questions. Tell us, when will these things happen, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end time? So sort of really three questions, but in reality, this is even printed as if it's just two questions, and it really is two questions. After answering the first question, and that's what Doug got to cover on Wednesday, the first question was, when is this going to happen? And he gives them some good signs about when it's going to happen. He's going to say, now, here are the things that will happen before Jerusalem is destroyed. Interestingly enough, Christians believe that, and so the Christians in Jerusalem had all left when Jerusalem was destroyed. Isn't that interesting? The Jews didn't leave, and they're going to face the terrible tribulation of the destruction of Jerusalem. But the Christians believed Jesus and heard Jesus, and they all left. It's sort of right. He sort of like says, if you read the newspaper, guys, you'll know when it's going to happen, because you'll know from the times. Yes.
We spoke on Wednesday about how Emperor Vitellius stepped down from power, or was killed, or whatever. But Vespasian left Jerusalem in charge of his son Titus.
Yeah, he ends up becoming emperor. Goes back to be emperor, and Titus, his son, will be the one who will really do the destruction of Jerusalem.
But it was during that break of the shifting of power that the Christians
left. Yeah, and basically they said, the newspapers are saying, there are no newspapers then, but they were saying, the time is clear. And again, if you had a television, you would see all of that stuff happening as we are today, but it was pretty clear when that's going to happen. The one thing that must happen before the second coming is the fall of Jerusalem. That's the one thing that has to. So when could it happen? Any time now. And I think if I back up to the text, notice it starts with "but immediately." You got to realize that with God, time is not time like we think of time. It's immediately, but it's been 2,000 years. But that's got to happen first. Jerusalem has to fall before Jesus will come back again and before the end time. And so I think that's important for us to see. It will be a time which no one knows. And later on, we're going to see that Jesus himself doesn't even know the time. It amazes me that folks predict the end time, and there have been thousands of predictions about when the end time is going to be from Jesus' day forward. People have been predicting it. Back in 2000, there were lots of predictions because they thought that number was going to be the magic number. You know, computers were going to stop working and the whole world will fall apart and it'll all be destroyed. So 2000 was one of those dates. 1988 was another date. But there are several dates when folks were predicting that. The sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. That language, by the way, is in several prophetic passages to describe the glorious return of Jesus. In Joel chapter 2, Revelation chapter 6, and Isaiah 34. All of them are going to talk about the end time being like that. And so that's, again, something terrible. And then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to the other. Okay, interesting language. When Jesus comes again, nobody is going to miss it. It's not going to be the tribulation that folks want to argue, that a lot of folks just missed it. And in fact, some of the folks who are predicting the tribulation are going to contend that that already happened. And some folks were already taken up. And normally, the 144,000 are the folks who get taken up, and the rest of the folks get stuck behind. And so that's going to be the normal prediction for those folks. Yes? Oh, yeah, yeah, he did, yeah, yeah, and those books that he's written are amazing, and I read one of them, and I just said, I'm not going to read any more of these, especially I'm not going to pay any money to read them, for him to make money off of it. It's not a picture of the rapture when Jesus comes and takes some and leaving others for a later return and the judgment day. See, the rapture argues that the folks who are really saints and really good are going to be taken up into heaven with Jesus. The rest of the folks will be left behind, and they kind of get a second chance. And we're living in that second chance period for them. From the foregoing exposition, this is from F.F. Bruce, I like it. From the foregoing exposition, it appears that the coming of the Son of Man is not to be identified with the judgment of Jerusalem. Those are not the same time. And by the way, there were folks who were arguing that the fall of Jerusalem was the end time. When Jerusalem falls, I mean, that's the important city. And when Jerusalem falls, that's got to be the end. The whole world's going to fall apart when Jerusalem falls. And that didn't happen. Now, learn from the parable of the fig tree. Now, interestingly enough, Jesus will jump back and forth. He talked about the fall of Jerusalem. He talks about his return, and I think he's going to shift back to the fall of Jerusalem now. But he's going to talk about both. And this parable, I think, is talking about the fall of Jerusalem. Now, learn from the parable of the fig tree. When the branches have already become tender and it puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So you too, when you see all these things, recognize He is near right at the door. God is near. When you see it in the signs of the time that I've told you about, and that's Vespasian taking leave and leaving Titus, etc., all of that's going to be clear. The fig tree has a regular pattern. The pattern is this. The fruit appears first. By the way, do you remember the little parable that Jesus enacts when he curses the fig tree? He goes there, and the tree's all leaves. And he says, well, there ought to be figs. And he goes to pick figs, and there are no figs on it. This is a confused tree. It's a messed up tree. Because the figs form first, and then the leaves. Now, the figs that form first are not particularly great for eating, but they're edible. At least that's what I'm told. I've never eaten one of those that early in the season, but that's what I'm told. And so it's the leaves will fall, and then summer will soon follow. So you can tell, if you're looking at a tree and it has leaves, it's summertime. By the way, if you remember in that, when Jesus curses the fig tree, the text says it was not the season for figs. Well, you think, well, why is he picking on that fig tree? It's not time for figs. Well, It had leaves. That tree isn't going to have any figs. And he makes a big deal of it. And I think he's really talking about the leaders in Jerusalem. They're all leaves, all show, but they're not producing any fruit. And I think that's really interesting. And we've seen that earlier in our text. When you see the leaves, you know summer is near, because that'll happen. The fig was a common fruit tree in Israel. And again, remember, Jesus acted that parable out when he curses the fig tree that has no fruits. The gospel writers tell us that it was not time for figs, but the tree was already in leaf. And it shouldn't have leaves at Easter time, Passover time, in March, April. It shouldn't have leaves yet. So this is a confused tree. The leaders in Jerusalem were all leaves but no fruit. Now he tells them that they will know when the destruction of Jerusalem is going to come. You will know it, guys. Just read the signs of the day. And again, the early Christians knew it. They left, which I think is interesting. And they'll go to a place called, well, in fact, some of the Jews will even leave, and they'll go to a place called Jamnia, and they'll go there. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Now, if Jesus is talking about the end time, he was deadly wrong, right? Because, see, he's saying this generation won't pass away till these take place. This is in AD 30-ish. 40 years from now, Jerusalem's going to be destroyed, AD 70. So a lot of the folks who are there, if you're 30 years old, in 40 years you'll be 70, but you'll still be around. Okay, got it? And so that becomes, I think, clear for us. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Notice Jesus is continuing with his destruction of Jerusalem language. But again, he talked about the destruction of Jerusalem, the second coming, and the judgment day. He comes back and he talks about the destruction of Jerusalem. And so that's what's caused folks lots of problems as they're looking at this text. They want it to all be about the same thing. And they've tried to adjust it accordingly. Some living then would see the fall of Jerusalem 30 years down the line, and so that will be important. It's really nearer 40 years down the line, probably. If Jesus had been talking about his second coming and the end time, he would have been wrong. Do you have room for Jesus to be wrong about what's happening? I don't have room for that. He's inspired by God. The end time, even when heaven and earth will pass away, his words are going to remain. What I'm telling you now is still going to be binding. You can count on me, he's saying. Even when terrible things happen to Jerusalem, you can count on me. I'm going to be here. I'm going to come and rescue my folks, take my folks up to heaven to be with me, etc. And so all of that will be important. But of that day and hour, no one knows, even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone. Now, that's really interesting. Again, amazing. It's amazing to me that people think they can predict the judgment day by reading what Jesus says, but he says, I don't know when it's going to be. When he comes as man, he has all this mysterious knowledge. You know, folks won't even say anything. He'll know what they're thinking. He will respond to what they're thinking. And he knows those things, and he knows what's going to happen. But one thing he doesn't know when he's here on the earth as man is when the second coming is going to be. Isn't that interesting? God has purposefully hidden it from him. And so that's, yes. I think so. His emptying himself, the fact that he pours himself out. And in a very real way, he becomes man. And becoming man, you know, he's given up omnipresence, right? God is everywhere. Doesn't make any difference where you are. God's there. God's with us today. God was with me in Nashville. God was with you wherever you were at Christmas time, at Thanksgiving time. He's with us wherever we are. But Jesus was in one place at a time when he was a man. And so he's sort of fixed by time while he's a man. And I think that's really interesting. He doesn't know the day. The angels don't know the day. Nobody knows the day. So I feel pretty good. When somebody predicts the Lord is going to come on October the 27th, 2023, I'm going to say, nah, that's not the day. Because if they're predicting it, they got it wrong. Because nobody knows the day or the hour. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. For in those days, before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. They did not understand until the flood came and took them all. When you see the leaves, you know the summer is near. Now, again, he's basically saying they didn't know when it was going to happen. There will be two men in a field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding in the mill. One will be taken, one will be left. They'll be, therefore, be on the alert, for you don't know the day your Lord is coming. Many want to contend this passage is about the rapture, because one taken, one left, and some are going to be left here. And I don't think that's quite the picture. The picture is God's going to come and rescue those of us who are believers and take us to be with him. The others are going to be taken, but they're going to face judgment. And so it really is interesting, but you see how folks who are big into the rapture kind of get it from these kind of passages, which I think they're misreading, but they want to contend that. Be sure of this, that if the head of the house had known the time of the night the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert and would not have allowed his house to be broken into. For this reason, you must also be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not know, do not think he will. The thief coming at night is a common metaphor for the second coming. Jesus will use it elsewhere, and he'll talk about that kind of thing. You see, if somebody's going to come and rob your house, and you just happen to have a shotgun around, you know, when he comes, you're going to have your shotgun ready to get him, right? Because you'll know he's coming. If you knew when he was going to come, you'd protect your house. You wouldn't allow that to happen. And so he makes a big deal of that. Be sure of this, if he had known he would have the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert and would not have allowed his house to be broken into. For this reason, you also must be ready. For the Son of Man is coming at an hour you do not think he will. And again, that's interesting. Who then is the faithful and sensible servant? He's going to shift gears with his parables here. A faithful and sensible servant whom the master puts in charge of his household to give them food at the proper time. Blessed is the slave whom his master finds so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you, he will put him in charge of all of his possessions. And so here is this master, and he's going to go on a trip, and he says, okay, you're my head slave, and I'm going to put you in charge. I want you to make sure that everybody gets their food and everything's taken care of. I want you to take care of everybody. And that's his job. And the one who does that, he says, will be blessed, because the master will find him doing what he asked him to do. He says he'll put him in charge of a lot. That's the way the master would operate. He's going to, when you come back, and if you've been that kind of good servant and taken care of folks and not been out partying, etc., God's going to bless you and he'll take care of you and you'll be blessed. But if the evil slave says in his heart, my master is not coming for a long time, and he begins to beat his fellow slaves and eat and drink with the drunkards, the master of that slave will come on a day when he does not expect him, an hour that he does not know, and will cut him in pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the kingdom of heaven will be comparable to 10 virgins. Okay, now we're going to shift gears and get another parable. And this is a parable about the second coming, the parable of the 10 virgins. We typically will call them the wise and foolish virgins, but that's not particularly a good translation. I'll talk about that in just a moment. Then the kingdom of heaven will be like comparable to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 were foolish and 5 were prudent. For the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the prudent took oil in flasks along with their lamps. Okay, the setting is fairly clear from what we know of marriage customs in those days. The marriage custom would be something like this. The bridegroom and some close friends are going to go from his house to his bride's house to get her and bring her back to his house because that's where the party's going to be. Okay? That's where the wedding will take place, at his family's house. And so there are various ceremonies, etc. There would be a ceremony at his in-law's house, and there'll be another ceremony at his house. And interestingly enough, wedding feasts back then could last for a full week. Thank goodness it's not that way today. Having had 3 daughters and the expense of 3 daughters and the weddings. And also, interestingly enough, it's the other way around. Guess who gets to pay for the weddings back then? The groom's parents pay for the weddings. Those of you who have had daughters, you know what that's like, but that's not the case. The groom's folks have to pay for the wedding. They go through various streets, and after nightfall, they'll get to back to his home after nightfall. And so they'll go get the bride, bring her, come to his house, and that's where these virgins are. The 10 virgins may well be bridesmaids. Now, I don't know what your weddings have been like with kids. Well, I counted one of our daughters had 9 bridesmaids. And my wife made all the dresses, including the wedding dresses as well as the bridesmaids' dresses, back in those days, long, long ago. But anyway, there are 10 of them. So this is, that's not terribly unusual, 10 of them, and they're waiting. They expect to meet the groom as he comes from the bride's house to his house. And so they're going to be waiting outside his house for him to come as a part of this grand festival. Everyone in the procession is expected to carry his or her own lamp. You got to carry your own lamp, your own light, and everybody's supposed to carry it. Those without the torch would be assumed to be party crashers or maybe even brigands, folks who come to steal whatever is available there. The festivities might last several days, would formally get underway at the groom's house, at his house, not at the bride's house. The lamps, and this is a different word that we got earlier. In chapter 5, you may remember he talks about the lamp, lighting your lamp and not putting it under a bushel. We sing that song. This is a different word for lamp. The word that is here is more like torch, or it could even be an oil-fed lamp, or it also could be a torch where you kind of dip your torch in the oil and keep it burning and dip it in there again to keep it burning. And so that could well be the case to keep it burning. But anyway, it's a different word for lamp. In either case, the prudent would bring along a flask with additional oil supplies. They are prudent. And the word there that is sometimes translated wise doesn't mean, the normal word for wise is the word we get sophist from, sophos, that's the word, normal word for wise. This is a different word altogether. It better is translated prudent. Although some translations will render the first word group as wise, the term is translated prudent, and a good example of this is in the parable of the wicked steward. You remember that parable? There's this wicked steward who's been wasting away his master's money, and the master basically comes and says, "Show me the books. I want to see where the money's gone." And he says, "Uh-oh, I'm in trouble. I'm going to lose my job." So what he does, he calls the debtors in, and he will reduce their debt. One by 50% and one by 20%. But he's going to reduce their debt so that he'll have friends on the other side. The master comes and says, "You have been prudent. You planned ahead." Shrewd, sometimes translated, yeah. But the word is better prudent. They are shrewd or prudent because they planned ahead. They're wise, but they're wise because they planned ahead. And so when Jesus comes again, those of us who have been wise will have been planned, have planned ahead and acted accordingly. We'll be excited for his coming. And so that becomes important for us. But the parable of the wicked steward is the best example of that word. They are prudent because they are prepared. They are prepared for the bridegroom's delayed coming, just in case he doesn't get there as soon as we thought he would. Now, while the bridegroom was delaying, he got delayed. He got at the bride's house, and they got to talking, and they were having a good time there, and he doesn't get left when he thought they would. They all get drowsy and began to sleep. But at midnight, when there was a shout, "Behold, the bridegroom, come out and meet him," then all the virgins rose and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the prudent, "Give us some of your oil for our lamps. Our lamps are going out." But the prudent answered, "There will not be enough for us and you too. Go instead to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." Now, I don't know whether they're going to get, what dealers are going to be open at midnight. You see, the idea is basically we're not going to give you any of ours because we planned ahead accordingly. Both the wise and prudent and the wise or prudent and the foolish virgins wait and they doze. By the way, dozing at midnight is not unusual. Sleeping is all right. It's not you have to stay up all night. That's not the picture. Dozing is okay. The announcement comes. There's no praise or blame attached to either group for dozing. And so that's interesting. The sole distinction between the two groups is this. The wise bring not only their lamps or their torches, but extra supply of oil in separate jars, while the foolish bring nothing, no extra oil at all. And the bridegroom is a long time coming. Midnight, the cry rings out. All the virgins wake up, trim their lamps, but the lamps of the foolish are quickly going out. It's a present tense. They are going out. The wise virgins cannot help them. The foresight and preparedness of the wise virgins cannot benefit the foolish. Interestingly enough, just because your grandma or grandpa or maybe mom or dad were faithful Christians isn't going to get you to heaven. Right? You know, it depends on you. You got to make your own decision. And he's making a big deal of that, I think. They can't depend on somebody else. We have to be prepared for the coming of the Lord ourselves. Somebody else's being prepared won't help us. Preparedness can neither be transferred nor shared. But while they were going away to make purchase, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the wedding feast, and the door was shut. Later, the other virgins also came saying, "Lord, Lord, open up for us." And he answered, "Truly I say to you, I don't know you. Be on the alert then, for you don't know the day nor the hour." The bridegroom comes, the wise ones enter, the door is shut. The intense cries of the ill-prepared, foolish latecomers, "Sir, sir," are of no avail. Keep watch doesn't mean keep awake. It means be alert, be prepared. The entire parable is this exhortation: be prepared, keep watching. And that's it. Okay, I did it. All right, comments or questions? Yes.
Going back to the what Jesus was saying about the destruction and the end times, parable in Matthew chapter. Harvest was signified, and if we're to put it in context.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. And he's making this big deal of. You can't pick and choose who's going to be who's saved and who's lost. You leave that up to God. That's not our job. We're not judges. God is the judge. And it won't happen until the harvest time, the end time. And so it's not going to be some kind of rapture in between. It's not that either. But Jesus is pretty consistent with the way he tells those parables. And that's a good point. Yes. Yeah. Terry. Yeah. Yeah. And how can you miss it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. How can somebody miss that? And again, it's, you know, notice this time he talks about the trumpets being sounded and the stars falling from the sky, and it's going to be so clear that you can't miss it. If you're prepared, you can't miss it. Whether you're prepared or not, you can't miss it. Prepared are going to say, "Oh no," and the others are going to be rescued. Other comments or questions? Yes.
Well, the religious world thinks Jerusalem is a very holy place, but it was the city that killed Christ.
Yeah, it is the city that killed Christ, and it really is interesting because when you get that kind of Jerusalem language, for example, in Revelation, it is not quite Jerusalem, Jerusalem. It's save folks wherever they are. So that's a good point. Yeah.
Where it says, everything will be destroyed by fire, the earth and all the elements will melt and heat. I mean, that's, you can't hardly deny that.
Yeah, yeah. That's very clearly a destruction of this earth as we know it. Yeah, that's exactly right. And again, it's really quite interesting because, again, if you have a good Mormon friends or a good Jehovah's Witness friends, they're going to contend the 144,000 get to go to heaven, and God's going to redo this earth, and the rest of us are going to be down here on this redone earth. But that's clearly not the picture that we get. But it's really quite interesting how they try to do that. Other comments or questions? Yes. Yes.
At that point,
they can't get into the ark later on. They can't crawl up and get on it somehow. Exactly. God shuts the door. And it's really quite interesting. When you may remember that the same word is used for shut and locked. It's used in Matthew 21. Matthew. Try again. John. In John, when the disciples are in this upper room, and the disciples minus Thomas are there, and Jesus will appear, but he comes through locked doors. The doors are shut and locked. And so here the doors are kind of shut and locked. They can't get in. But that's a good point, yeah. And it's the same word that's used, yeah. Yeah, yeah, you got to let him in. And again, I think that picture is not a picture of the judgment day, but a picture rather of his inviting us to be his people. The invitation that we've all received. The invitation that you'll hear him give at the end of our lesson today, which is really an invitation for folks to respond who need to respond. And Jesus is knocking at the door and inviting them to come in. Yeah. Yeah, in Revelation.
Yeah,
yeah. 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 They're the ones who are just lukewarm. And he says, "I'm going to spew you out of my mouth." Yeah. Other comments or questions? Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that would have been a great sermon. And it really is amazing because after his resurrection, nobody seems to know him at first. They don't because they don't expect to see him, and so they're assuming he's somebody else. Mary Magdalene thinks he's the gardener. They think he's just a traveler. They don't know who he is. And then, but interestingly enough, in that story, with the Emmaus story, he says the prayer over the food, and they say, that's Jesus. Because he prays just like Jesus. That's Jesus.
What did it say? Their hearts
burned. Yeah. Okay, anybody else? All right, we've got a few minutes before we start again. Let's pray as we close. Dear Lord, we thank you so much for your word, and we pray, Lord, that you'd help us to be ready for your coming. We are mindful of those parables where Jesus indeed warns us that we need to be ready and prepared. Help us to be prepared and anxious for your return, and we pray you'd receive us as your people. We thank you again for your word and for the hope that it gives us as your disciples. Be with us as we study it and help us to put it into practice and help us to be ready. We thank you, Lord, for those blessings that are ours in Christ Jesus, and we pray in his name. Amen.